Thank you for inviting me to come here. I'm not going to say very much because I feel very humbled by some of the things that have been said already and the amount of people who have come out tonight in support of the movement. As well as being an academic, I have a split role where I also work for Norfolk and Suffolk Foundation Trust. I work with families with very young children in Great Yarmouth. And I feel a bit conflicted about even telling you this, but actually that bit of our service is actually growing. We're helping more families with very young children. We're helping mothers in the maternity period. We're not doing enough. We're not accessing the community in the way we need to, but we are doing more. And so I feel humbled to hear so much about the shrinkage that's happening as well. Unfortunately, the reason we are expanding it is because we have to make an economic argument. We have to say that helping these tiny, defenceless babies now will save us money in 10, 15, 20 years' time. Now, that is not a good enough reason to provide good quality mental health services to families. We have to do it because it's the right thing for us to do as a society, to take collective responsibility for looking after one another, not some bottom line economic argument that I make myself in order to get the services that I think our families need. So in addition to being an NSFT clinician working with families, I have another role where I'm an academic at the University of Essex, and some might say that my role in that sense is rather split or almost schizophrenic. Because what I do there is, as well as training clinical psychology trainees, I actually do a fair amount of research and teach and talk about how mental health services are not good enough at redressing the inequality and the toxic social environment that we're living in the modern era. It's not enough to scrape people up off the ground, to look after people who have been abused, to come in after they've had years and years and years of disadvantage and say, we're going to provide you with some therapy or some medication or some kindness. That's not good enough. I think we need to look at the root causes of what leads to 1 in 4 people in our society, the 4th or 5th biggest economy in the world. That's the number of people who we have who are diagnosed as being mentally ill. And what are we saying? That the other 3 out of 4 are fine? I don't think that they are. The epidemiological evidence would not suggest that they are. What it suggests is, over 40 years, that actually inequality and a neoliberal market system that thrives upon inequality makes us sick. All of us. So against that backdrop, mental health services are only ever going to be able to shore up and do the bare minimum to help people. But my God, it's the least we can do. The least we can do in the face of the rampant rise in inequality in our society and the damage that it causes all of us is to move beyond talking about depression, anxiety, psychosis as if they are things that just afflict some of us and to find a way to talk about mental health and the suffering that we're all going through as a result of the way that we're reorganising this society and in a completely anti-democratic way dismantling the social contract that we made after the end of the Second World War. So I think in that context, what I think is that mental health services are not going to be enough to help us to have good communities, good societies, to have a level of trust with one another. But it's a pretty good start. And I think that the way that people come into mental health services is not because they have some psychological dysfunction or a psychiatric morbidity. It's because they have suffered interpersonal injuries. They have suffered injuries of relationships. Whether it be the baby who can't thrive and can't develop because their mother and father are too preoccupied with their own traumas and distress to be able to really focus. Or whether it's because that baby actually, the family don't have enough material resources around them to keep them safe, to keep them secure. So I think that what brings people into our services, and I've been on both sides of the consultant table on this, so I can speak with authority from both angles. What brings people into our services is the harm that we do to one another, the harm that we do in terms of relationships, in terms of the wider social structures that we live in, and that we are in some way collectively responsible for, even if we would rather other it on the politicians or bureaucrats or managers. So the least we can do for one another is ensure that we have mental health services that put quality relationships at the very, very heart of what we do. And I'm afraid that the cuts that are going on make that more and more and more difficult for us to do every day. If damage through interpersonal relationships is what causes us to be distressed and to such an extent that we have a diagnosis of a mental health problem, it is the quality of the relationship with professionals, family members and friends that will ultimately heal us. I think that services only do so much. And actually, solidarity, friendships, relationships across the divide that are here tonight in themselves can be healing. And I think that the fight is big that we have here. There's a big political system that has to be taken on. And I guess I just don't want people to be damaged through the process of fighting and to take some solace from the solidarity that people are expressing towards one another tonight. And I'll finish with a quote from the Italian Marxist Antonio Gramsci. And he said, "Pessimism of the intellect, optimism of the spirit." Thank you.